the process with the city to bring a new process of electing officials. Past the last 4 or 5 decades, it's been you vote for, let's say city council, you vote for 1 or 2 or 3 candidates, and whoever gets the most votes wins. So that system, a lot of people say it's flawed because you get the same 40,000 residents in the city of Detroit voting for similar types of candidates who are going to only appease those residents' needs. And so, a perfect example is Southwest and down by 4217. Historically, never really represented by anybody on city council. So, first page is new districts. There's 7 districts. We are currently in District 6, the second page. Look at it. District 6 includes Woodbridge, Corktown, parts of Midtown and downtown, all the way up to John R. And then the heart of Southwest, up by 96 and 94, and then all the way down to 4217 downriver. It's the largest district out of all the districts, about 107,000 residents. If you go to the third page, most people think that a majority of poverty and lack of education is on the east side of Detroit. In reality, Southwest and this whole District 6 is the poorest and least educated of all the districts. Nearly 40% of all residents who are adults in District 6, in this area, do not have a GED or a high school diploma. So we're looking at 2 out of 5 individuals, adults. Also, it's the poorest. While some of the areas here make around $22,000 per capita income, in District 6, it's around $16,000, a little over $16,000. And what does that say about this district? It says 2 things. One, that there's a huge disparity amongst city council members and people of City Hall and them representing their needs. Fundamentally, now is going to be a very, very crucial crux time within your area to represent and elect somebody who's going to not just be your voice, but be responsible for you on the city level. Currently, within this district, there have been 2 people who have been running at the city council. That's Ken Cockrell and Joanne Watson. Both of them currently, one isn't running. Mr. Cockrell's voice of opinion is not running for this election. And then the other one, Joanne Watson, is still undecided, but it seems that she'll be leaning against not running as well. That leaves a huge space and opportunity for somebody in the community to come and rise and represent the communities of Southwest. And the last thing I want to make obviously it's apparent, but we go through it really quickly. When you look at the diversity of the districts, District 6 is by far the diverse and I would say inclusive district of all of Detroit. Well, you see, if you look at the numbers here, you can see obviously high African American populations in all the other districts. District 6, the largest, only 40% of the entire district is the Hispanics. So you have a huge opportunity here to elect somebody who's going to hear your voice in that area. Next, you have the African American population, which makes up about 40%. And then the other unique characteristic, which you won't see in any other districts, is that in District 6, in this area, the Caucasian population makes up about 18%, which is not, in the other districts, it's probably.
What about Native Americans? Oh,
Native Americans falls under my category, other races. We are 4%. And in all honesty, that's pretty much average in all the other districts. So one of the things that, if you look at the last page, you'll see a number of individuals who are running for this district. One of the things I wanted to get, and I'm not even running, I'm just full petition. So let me see this out and say the difference between running and pulling a petition. If you are interested in running for a position, this case city council, you have up until May 14th to pull a petition from the city clerk's office. You go to the city clerk's office, you say, hey, I am, in this case, Neil Singh, I want to run for city council. They will give you a series of petitions. They give you 44 pages, and they have 50 signatures on each page. And it's your job to get 300 signatures by registered voters. So, like, you saw my petition going around, you saw Ty Carter's...
Raquel's
here as well. You've seen this going around, and I want to explain the process to you how it works. So fundamentally, you have to get at least 300. Most people get 400, 500, 600 because you have people who say they're registered voters, or you have people who think that they live in your district, and in reality they don't. So you have until May 14th. Once May 14th hits, whoever has 300 registered voters on their petition signed and submitted to the city clerk's office, their name officially goes on the ballot. And from there forth, they have, the whole process of running for 4 or 5 months until August of the primaries. And then you vote for who you feel is the most appropriate representative for you, and who you feel is going to come to meetings, who's going to hear your problems, and hopefully try to solve some of the issues here in your community. In August, there's a primary election, and then from all the candidates that have made it to that process, two will run for the position of city council. And that election is in November, obviously. Every November, you go out, or every 4 years in November, you go out to elect city council. Madam. One of the things, that's the last thing, real quick, I wanted to, I probably already said it, going really well in a second here, but it is crucial that you guys have an opportunity like somebody who is going to, you hear about the emergency manager, you hear about the emergency manager taking a substantial amount of power away from city council, and what's the city council going to do, what's the police commissioner going to do. Fundamentally, there's an opportunity here for, regardless of what your views are on the emergency manager, to elect somebody who is going to try working, maybe it's on a community level, and to get all the community-based organizations, churches, block clubs, CCs, together within now we have a very small district. It's not the whole city anymore. It's just a very concrete area to start serving the entire area of District 6. So there's going to be a whole bunch of people that are going to be coming by in the next 2, 3, 4, 5 months. They're going to be talking a lot about themselves, their experience, and what they can do for the city. And all I can tell you is that there's a lot of news reports and negative ideas about this election and how it can possibly not be worthwhile for you to come out and vote. And I will tell you by far this is the one chance that you have to actually elect somebody that maybe not this year, maybe not the next year, but if you get the emergency manager to go away and you can find someone who's going to be vested in your interest, it can truly make a difference for you. Does anyone have any questions?
Yeah.
I don't know if I'll be able to answer them.
What's your favorite color?
Yeah.
If someone, let's say someone wanted to run for city council, how do they know that that position will still be around next year after the EFM
decides?
I'm just saying, they keep saying broke. Are they going to be like laying these people off?
Well, they're going on a part-time position. Right?
Oh, or is it part-time? Yeah.
So all really good questions because they're all honestly hearsay. Nobody knows for certain exactly what's going to happen with city council. A lot of people think that fundamentally they're salaries are going to get cut. A lot of people think fundamentally that they are going to go down to part-time. This all could be true, could not be true. All that we know for certain is that this process has been part of the city charter for eons. And when emergency managers have come into play, while in some cases certain individuals on city council have been stifled, there still is an opportunity to do good work for the community and for, in this case, your district. So to answer your question, no one has an idea exactly what's going to happen.
Yeah.
But the truth is that even if you do have somebody who's going to say, listen, city council is going to have as much power as before and it's going to be substantially smaller, it doesn't mean that those people who are going to be represented by the people here, I was going to have some sort of power and influence and at least the community level of organizing.
Wouldn't they have to vote?
Would they have to vote?
Part of the, isn't it part of the city charter to have so many people in place? And in order for the financial manager to cut that, don't they have to take a vote on this stuff?
Well,
see, I don't understand the ultimate power this guy has. You know what?
No, I think we all are fundamentally very, very fearful of how reaching this emergency matters is going to be, and I do believe he will probably overreach over than what the legislation actually intended him for him to do.
I think we need to watch.
But what you need to know, and the thing is, a lot of what he said, I don't need to know what he does, and I'm going to stay right, but I didn't know that they had to collect signatures. I haven't sat down and read the charter and did like a dissertation on it or anything like that. You know, I just like the idea of council by district because I've had so many issues in our 80%.